When producing videos, one vital piece of equipment is a decent studio microphone to record voiceovers. For about 3 years, I've been using this T-Bone SC440 USB studio microphone. But then one day, the USB connector broke. As a fitting replacement, I got myself its successor, the SC450, which you can get for around 90 euro. But if we take apart my old broken microphone, we can for one find two PCBs which utilize the AK5371 2-channel analog to digital converter as the brains of the organization. And if we dig a bit deeper, we can also discover the heart of the microphone. This cylinder-shaped piece of metal with two wires coming out of it is a so-called condenser microphone, aka condenser capsule, aka capacitor microphone, however you want to call it. So in this episode of DIY or Buy, we will have a closer look at different microphone types and create a DIY microphone amplifier circuit in order to find out whether DIYing a microphone is an adequate alternative to buying a proper studio microphone. And for the final showdown, we will compare the microphones by building up a test setup and playing back different music clips. Which brings me to the sponsor of this video, Audioblocks. They offer one of the largest stock audio library with over 100,000 clips, loops, music and sound effects. And best of all their audio clips come with a royalty-free agreement. So I, and possibly you, can use them in YouTube videos without getting in trouble due to copyright claims. They are currently giving out a 7-day trial period, so you can give it a shot and get access to their massive stock audio library for free. Just visit audioblocks.com/YouTube or click the link in the video description to get started with your free trial. And with that being said, let's get started with the video. Now the job of such a condenser microphone is to convert sound waves into an electrical signal, which we then can record with, for example, a computer. To do that, the condenser microphone consists of a thin membrane and a solid metal plate, which together build up a plate capacitor. When the sound waves hit the diaphragm, it changes its distance to the solid plate, and thus, according to the capacitance formula of a plate capacitor, the capacitance of the setup changes. But in order to get a proper electrical signal out of this, we would need to charge up the capacitor through a bias resistor, with a high voltage of up to 48 volts, which is also known as phantom power. This way, since we got an almost constant charge, the voltage changes of the capacitor reflect the capacitance changes and thus the sound waves. Pretty awesome! Only problem is that such condenser capsules cannot easily be purchased. Except of course if you would buy a proper studio microphone, but that would destroy the DIY aspect. Instead, we could focus on these Electret condenser microphones. Those can be bought for very cheap, and almost all small microphones nowadays are of such a kind. Even the lavalier microphone that I use for my Q&A videos is one of them. Their structure is similar to that of a condenser microphone, but like the name of this microphone type implies, there is a film of electret between the two capacitor plates, which therefore polarizes the capacitor naturally, without the need of phantom power. And once we take apart such a microphone, which is honestly easier said than done, then we can find an additional field effect transistor connected to one capacitor plate. This FET is used for power amplification, which means all we have to do is to add a 1 kilo ohm resistor and a 1 microfarad capacitor to the circuit and power it with a voltage of above 1.5 volts to get our audio signal on the output. So I added those components to the capsule, applied 5 volts to the circuit, hooked the output up to my oscilloscope and realized that everything worked like it was supposed to. And connecting such an Electret condenser capsule to a computer is even easier, We simply have to plug an audio cable into the mic in port, connect the right ring to the minus pole of the capsule, which you can identify by the traces going to the housing, and connect the other two ring contacts to the plus pole of the capsule. The way this works is that the sound cards includes the mandatory resistor and capacitor, which means that by checking the recording devices, the microphone should work just fine. But make sure to disable all enhancements your sound card offers, otherwise they can mess up the recording. Next, I opened the software Audacity, created the small test setup, and started the recording of a music clip. As you can hear, the microphone works just fine, but you should also hear, and probably see it due to the audio waveform, that the volume is a bit low. One way to increase this recording volume is to utilize the microphone boost Windows provides, which, as you can once again hear and see, does work. But the problem is that you simultaneously increase the noise floor. For better understanding, here's a silent recording without boost, and here's one with boost. As you could hear, the capsule alone is not the best solution yet, since it only features peak-to-peak voltages of around 200 millivolts at best. So obviously, we need a decent amplifier. For that, I created this small schematic. Like before, the 1K resistor powers the FET, while the two parallel 470 nanofarad capacitors remove the DC offset of the audio signal. Then we got the NJM5532 low noise op amp in an inverting op amp configuration with a gain of around 21. The voltage divider on the non-inverting inputs is utilized to create a 2.5 volt offset voltage at which the output voltage will oscillate around. Last but not least, we got a high pass filter and a low pass filter with cutoff frequencies of 3.6 Hz and 15.9 kHz, which should get rid of unwanted frequencies. And with the theory out of the way, I gathered all the required components and started soldering them all to a small piece of perf board. After a mere 30 minutes of soldering, the circuit was complete. And after inserting the IC, connecting the microphone, and powering the circuit with 5V power, it was time for a first test. On the oscilloscope, we can see that we now got peak-to-peak voltages of up to 3V, which means that the amp should increase the volume. So after reconnecting the right ring to ground, and this time only the far left ring contact to the output of the amp, it was time for another test recording. But in order to have a proper reference value, I firstly utilized my usual studio microphone to record a bit of music. Here is the unedited result. And here is what the small Electret microphone delivered. Now both mics fulfill their job without a problem. But to no surprise, the studio microphone offers a better recording quality.
Not convinced yet? Well, this is what the voiceover recorded by the Electret condenser microphone sounds like. Again, definitely usable, but not nearly as good as the studio microphone.
So when it comes to recording voiceovers, the buy option definitely wins in this case.
But if we compare the recording quality of my lavalier microphone, which sounds like this, with the recording quality of my DIY microphone, which sounds like this,
it is clear that when the lavalier mic costs around 57 euro, that the DIY version for around 4 euro is the winner. But what do you think? And what future episodes of DIY or buy would you like to see? As always, thanks for watching. Don't forget to like, share and subscribe. Stay creative. And I will see you next time.